covalent disease, it is the most common cause of secondary amenorrhea. And basically, the patients with polycystic ovarian disease, they usually come with only three complaints. Either it is amenorrhea, or it is obesity, or it is infertility. Okay. Now, there is certain criteria for diagnosis of PCOD. One that is known as the Rotterdam's criteria. This is asked in your exams. What do you mean by Rotterdam criteria? So you should be knowing that what is Rotterdam criteria, because nowadays in your new edition of Datta, the criteria is given, but it is not named Rotterdam. And previous examiners, they will be they have all gone through their previous books, so they'll be asking you Rotterdam's 2004 criteria for diagnosis of PCOS. So this criteria, it comprises of any two of the three complaints. First is oligo or anovulation. Second is hyperandrogenism. And third is polycystic ovaries. So if any two of the three symptoms are present, then you will say that she is having polycystic ovarian disease. If the patient comes to you with the complaint of secondary amenorrhea, there are other clinical features also associated with it. So what are the other clinical features? First, most common is the menstrual irregularity. This can be in the form of amenorrhea or irregular cycles. The second complaint is infertility. The third complaint is obesity. However, nowadays, non-obese PCOS patients. Next complaint is hyperandrogenism. And because of this hyperandrogenism, there can be acne, hirsutism, or alopecia. And lastly, acanthosis nigricans may be present. This is pigmentation. You will see linear marks in the neck area. Now, one more thing which is asked in your exam is the Heron syndrome. Heron syndrome, it comprises of hyperandrogenism, insulin resistance, and acanthosis nigricans. These three triad is known as the Heron syndrome. Now, once the patient comes to you with all these clinical features, you need to diagnose her whether she's suffering from PCOS or not. So what are the investigations you will go for? The most common, reliable, and diagnostic investigation for PCOS is ultrasonography. In ultrasonography, you will find a necklace pattern in the ovaries. What is this necklace pattern? Here, 2 to 10 follicles of 2 to 9 millimeter in them will be arranged peripherally around the and in a form of a necklace that is known as the necklace pattern. So ultrasonography is the best modality for the confirmation of polycystic ovaries. However, you can confirm it by a laparoscopic examination also. You can see the polycystic ovaries on your diagnostic laparoscopy. And there are certain, when you are going for ultrasonography also, you need to examine certain criteria in it. Then only you will label it as a PCOS. You need to find 12 or more follicles in the ovaries. And each follicle should be of 2 to 9 millimeter in diameter, and the ovarian volume should be more than 10 centimeter, cubic centimeter. Okay. So ovarian morphology on ultrasound is very important, and on the basis of this thing only we can say that the patient is having polycystic ovarian disease. However, there is some endocrinological abnormalities also in PCOS patients, and there is elevated LH and there can be normal FSH level. There is elevated LH-FSH ratio. There is elevated androgens level. There is low serum sex hormone binding globulin level. Mildly level. Elevated fasting and abnormal glucose tolerance test is there. And there is slight dyslipidemia also. Basically, what happens in PCOS patients, because of there is an ovulation. So why is there an ovulation? There is increased androgen production from the theca cells and from the stroma of the ovaries, which gets partially converted into estrone in the adipose tissue. And there is increased androgen levels. Because of this increased androgen levels, the serum sex hormone binding globulin level decreases in the body. And once this is decreased, the free estrogen and free testosterone level is increased. So this increased estrogen level would cause endometrial hyperplasia, and because of there is an ovulation also, so there is failure of development of the corpus luteum also. So since the corpus luteum is not formed, the progesterone is not formed because corpus luteum forms progesterone. Since there is no progesterone and there is unopposed action of estrogen in the body, so there is excessive endometrial hyperplasia, and this endometrial hyperplasia can lead to in future carcinoma of the endometrium also. So that is why we say that if the endometrium is hyperplastic, it should be treated within 3 to 6 months. Otherwise, there is chances of developing carcinoma later in her life. So also there is decreased due to insulin resistance, there is hyperinsulinemia and hyperandrogenism, and obesity. So these women, they are at high risk for long-term consequences. What are the long-term consequences? That is development of some metabolic diseases like diabetes mellitus, dyslipidemia, coronary heart disease, later on endometrial carcinoma and breast carcinoma. So these are the long-term consequences of PCOS. However, short-term consequences includes only obesity, menstrual abnormalities, there is anovulation, infertility, and if at all she conceives, there is chances, high risk of abortion. Then because of androgen, hyperandrogenism, there will be acne, hirsutism, alopecia, and because of insulin resistance, there is glucose intolerance and acanthosis nigricans. So these are the short-term consequences, and long-term consequences includes diabetes mellitus, endometrial carcinoma, breast carcinoma, and dyslipidemia, hypertension, and cardiovascular diseases. Now, once the patient comes to you with the complaint of all these things, you need to treat the patient. Now, polycystic ovarian disease, it is multifactorial. So there are so many factors. So you have to categorize the patient that which factor is important in her part. Means when the patient comes to, if suppose she is an unmarried girl and there is no chances of fertility related symptoms to be cured. So you will only concentrate on her irregular cycles. You need to just give some contraceptive pills, and particularly those pills in which this hyperandrogenism is corrected. Because basically in unmarried girls, the problem is problem with them is because of hirsutism and weight gain and irregular cycles. So this is the main complaint of unmarried girls. So here your main treatment should be targeted for weight reduction. Weight reduction is very important in obese patients, and this should be the, particularly the first line of management. Here, if you just reduce the weight of the patient, you actually reduce the BMI. There is decrease in the BMI, impaired glucose tolerance is little bit improved, hyperandrogenism, and everything is improved. So weight reduction at least improves the metabolic syndrome and reproductive function in future also. So you will ask that patient to motivate her to go for exercises. Then related to her menstrual irregularities, first of all, you need to control the hyperandrogenism which is there. So combined oral contraceptive pills are very effective. There is progesterone, which suppresses the LH, and estrogen improves the sex hormone binding globulin level. So it reduces the free testosterone level in her body. So you can give progesterone to the patient. Also, you know that because of anovulation, the corpus luteum is not formed, so the progesterone is absent. And because of this absence of the progesterone, the patient is having endometrial hyperplasia. You can just give only medroxyprogesterone acetate to that patient for her bleeding, or you can give combined oral contraceptive pills also. The next complaint is hirsutism in these young girls. Because of anovulation and high androgen and insulin level, there is decreased hepatic sex hormone binding globulin level, which leads to decreased because of this, there is decreased sensitivity of the hair follicles to androgens. So correction of this metabolic syndrome is important. Anti-androgens like cyproterone acetate, spironolactone, flutamide can be given for correction of hirsutism. And if medical treatment fails, then you can go for laser therapy or electrocautery to remove the hairs, extra hairs. As far as the metabolic syndrome is concerned, that is hyperinsulinemia, that is insulin resistance. This insulin resistance, it causes hyperandrogenemia. So insulin resistance is also associated with diabetes mellitus, obesity, dyslipidemia, and hypertension. So you will give metformin to that patient. This metformin will increase the insulin sensitivity. It decreases the weight of the patient and the BMI, and it reduces the low density lipoprotein level, the cholesterol level, the blood pressure, as well as the risk of developing diabetes. Next thing which you need to cure in these young girls is hyperinsulinemia by metformin. Then endometrial hyperplasia in these unmarried girls. This endometrial hyperplasia is because of chronic anovulation. It is because of hyperestrogenemia. It is because of obesity. It is because of hyperinsulinemia. All these factors causes endometrial hyperplasia, and in later years can lead to endometrial cancer also. Therefore, endometrial biopsy is indicated if she is postmenopausal. However, if it is a young girl, you can just give combined oral contraceptive pills that will prevent the endometrial hyperplasia and the abnormal bleeding. Now, when the patient is of reproductive age group and she is desirous of pregnancy also, here the main criteria of treatment is infertility. It is not irregular menses. It is actually infertility. So in these patients, your treatment will be based on ovulation. How will you go for ovulation? You will go for ovulation induction protocols. The most commonly we give clomiphene citrate. However, clomiphene citrate has estrogen as well as anti-estrogenic effect both. So because of that, there is ovulation, but the endometrial thickness is very less. So in that cases, we have seen particularly in PCOS patients that if the patient is not responding to clomiphene citrate, then you can give letrozole also. Letrozole is very effective and there is no effect on the endometrial thinning. So here you will get a good endometrial thickness as well as good follicles for pregnancy to occur. And if the patient is not responding to clomiphene or your letrozole therapy, then you can switch over to injectable drugs. Injections of pure FSH or human menopausal gonadotropin, that is HMG, can be given for the follicles to develop. And once the follicles attain a size of 18 to 20 millimeter, you will give HCG injection to rupture the follicles. Human chorionic gonadotropin injections are given in the dose of 5,000 to 10,000 units. And then you will ask them to plan their pregnancy. Now, insulin sensitizers have also been reported to be associated factor that will help in the pregnancy. So you can combine metformin in these patients with clomiphene. When you are giving clomiphene for induction, ovulation induction, you can combine with metformin also. Now, metformin improves the metabolic syndrome by reducing all the parameters. That is, it reduces the weight, the BMI, so hyperinsulinemia, hyperandrogenism, blood pressure and lipid abnormalities, all these are corrected. So 500 milligram thrice a day is found to be effective to correct all these abnormalities. However, pioglitazone and rosiglitazone is also being used in cases which are resistant to metformin. Now, if the patient is not responding to your medical treatment and she is still desirous of pregnancy, you can go for ovarian drilling. Okay, here what we do, we puncture two to three follicles of the ovaries. The depth of about 2 to 4 millimeter, you will puncture the cyst up to the depth of 2 to 4 millimeter. And it is a very good procedure, and it has replaced the conventional wedge resection of the ovaries, which was done previously. However, the pregnancy rates following ovarian dithermy is very high. Also, you can go for bariatric surgery if you are seeing that the patient is quite obese. Okay, so in all patients with PCOS, it depends upon the symptoms the patient is manifesting with, the age of the patient, and then only, and whether she is married, unmarried, then only you will decide which treatment is applicable to her. However, this polycystic ovaries is not completely cured. So counseling of the patient is very important, because these patients get demotivated easily, that in spite of taking treatment from 6 months or for 1 or 2 years, she is not cured as yet. So you have to counsel the patient very well, and you ask her to control her weight before she gets married, or because it has been seen that in PCOS patients, the first and most important treatment is weight reduction. Once the patients become very obese, then it is really difficult for them to reduce their weight. Okay, so symptomatic treatment is important in cases of polycystic ovarian disease. And in the exams also, it will be asked in your exams, this polycystic ovarian disease as a short note, or it could be asked in your table viva also, because in we have sonography film of a polycystic ovaries, the necklace pattern is seen. So if you get that sonography film, then you have to be answer the entire topic of PCOS in front of the examiner. So you should be knowing that it is the most common cause of secondary amenorrhea. What do you mean by secondary amenorrhea? It is a condition in which the patient has not resumed her menses for 6 months. If she's having the previous normal regular cycles, and if her cycles are irregular, then you can say assume that the absence of period for at least 3 months in the case of irregular cycles. And if she's having regular cycles, then 6 months of amenorrhea is considered as a case of secondary amenorrhea. The pathophysiology part, you have you can go through your books also in details all. And the Rotterdam's criteria, that is again very important. It is asked in your exams. So Rotterdam's criteria is important. The necklace pattern is important. The treatment part. And in the treatment part, the clinical features. Clinical features is the patient will, first or foremost, she will be complaining of only irregular cycles, that is oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea. And there is acne and hirsutism. There is all these clinical features, whatever is there, your treatment will be dependent upon the clinical features the patient is presenting with. And depending upon the age of the patient, you will go for that particular treatment, particularly in the young girls. Then if she's desirous of pregnancy, if she's non-desirous of pregnancy. Okay, so that is all about polycystic ovarian disease. And this is a very important topic for your exams. So just go through it from your books. Okay, so that is all for today. Thank you.